you know, telling our people that we have a, we are building on a foundation that is damaged. The House of Nigeria was being erected on a foundation that could not carry it because the original foundation had been destroyed. And for 53 years, 54 now, we just refused to go back to working on that foundation. And everything else we see is, you know, emanating from that refusal to go to address, like doctors who do, you know, if we start from symptoms, we remember that in September of 2020, the Vice President, Professor Oshimbajo, had raised an alarm that the walls of Nigeria were cracked. And that if we did not hasten up to find answers to it, that the building, the edifice may come down, crashing. And in 2-3 days after he said so, I had cause to be on Channel TV telling everybody on the 60th anniversary, that was their, you know, their flagship program for Nigeria's 60th anniversary. And I was saying that on behalf of these initiatives, that it is the foundation of Nigeria that have been damaged for a long time, but which we continue to construct upon, that is reason for that cracked cracked walls. And that it has come to where, unless something happens to take down the building for reconstruction, it will collapse on everybody and consuming lives that may run in millions. And so all of what you've read out as where we're coming from on it is simply an intervention, a comprehensive framework of intervention to arrest that situation before it becomes a human carnage that the global community will have to worry about. Like we remember in August of 2019 that the UN had called to send their special rapporteur to Nigeria, Agnes Callamard, who had to come to find out why blood was flowing all over Nigeria. Soldiers were killing, policemen were killing, herdsmen were killing, Boko Haram was killing, everybody killing everybody. And after 1 month of investigation, she came out with a report that it was Nigeria's constitutional arrangement that was like pressure cooker for injustice. So all the agitations, everything that has gone wrong from whether it's corruption we're discussing or lack of electricity or lack of good leadership or elections that are always upside down or whatever it is, I have a copy of the constitution here with me. I'm going to be able to show us today so that we can know exactly the nature of the ailment we have to treat. Because if we do not diagnose properly, like doctors who do, we've seen the symptom. Nigeria has become the global capital for poverty. Nigeria is one of the most unsafe places to live in. You know, the business, what do they call ease of doing business index, we are the rock bottom. We are number one in everything bad. And the last in everything good. Mortality rates, both for maternal and infant. At every side you look, Nigeria, is coming right from the rear. It is the foundation upon which we are building that is responsible. And if we go away from this program today, knowing exactly what the problem is and the options of solutions that are viable, are ready, available right now to apply to it, then we may join in pushing towards that direction of solving the problem, other than pretending we don't have a problem until people begin to die in such great numbers. It has come to where a majority, and as you see in the map, in the rear, a majority in that Nigeria are no longer concerned about what will happen to Nigeria. Our concern now is what will happen to the Nigerians that are trapped in that what has become for them some kind of a caliphate prison that has them just on the guillotine to be killed. They are not going to wait to die. They are all saying that it's better to escape by any means than waiting to be killed by all kinds of things coming at them. You know, so that's the situation we are in. That our country, the Nigeria that is defined by this constitution that was imposed is no longer our project. And all the institutions, founded on that constitution, including the National Assembly, including the Nigerian army, including the Nigerian police. If you want to know what we mean by that, you go to the preamble to that constitution to see that it is alleged in that preamble that we, the people, have solemnly resolved to live in unity as one indivisible country. Therefore, making and giving unto ourselves the following constitution. That is the claim. Everything, including how Ijoland became part of Nigeria, in which Nigeria is now the owner of the oil and gas assets of Ijoland. How Yorubaland, that could be a country of 60 million people, became part of Nigeria. And therefore, Lagos Port is at the discretionary disposal of Fulani that have been controlling it from the beginning. So in all of that, everywhere you look, even the killings going on in the Middle Belt, is all coming from that constitution in which the arms and ammunitions are on exclusive list, and therefore only the federal government can issue arms. None of the governors can issue one rifle to anybody. Meanwhile, there are people coming, people they can identify, who are coming to kill people in their spaces. And the federal government not only is unwilling or unable to deal with the matter, actually in collusion, openly supporting what's going on. And it's come to where you saw the governor in Benue asking people to go to take up arms, whatever they find, to defend themselves. What kind of country are we building in that? It is no longer, everybody is now looking out for how to defend themselves from people who are known. It cannot be said that nobody in government, at the federal government level, knows where they're coming from. We saw all of how it built up from Boko Haram to herdsmen, and now they call it bandits. But there's one common strand. There's Fulani at the center of it. At the time, we have a Fulani president who was the spokesman of the Boko Haram that became ISWAP upon joining forces with ISIS in 2014. He, to date, our president remains the grand patron of Mieti Allah, that have been taking responsibility for the activities and actions, the murderous actions of Fulani herdsmen. Our president, has no other business, he has declared, than rearing of cows. So if he remains the patron or life patron of Mieti Allah, at the time Mieti Allah is taking responsibility for the actions of Fulani herdsmen that have been adjudged the third most the dangerous terror group on the face of the earth. And we're here discussing it with nothing coming from government to show that they're even engaging the matter. Rather, we saw where 100 billion naira was taken from the treasury and given to that Mieti Allah. Where would the money end up other than the hands of people who are going to, the herdsmen themselves, who will be buying more arms to terrorize everybody? We saw where El-Rufai told us on national TV how he went to 14 different countries to give them money, the people who are coming to kill your governor in Kaduna. People are coming to kill the people you are supposed to be protecting. All you can do about it is to take money from the poor treasury of Kaduna State to go to give to those people in 14 different countries. And you are proud to come to tell us that was what you were doing about the killings. And then we see in Southern Kaduna all of how those killings have been managed. They say they came from this, he confirmed that they come from outside Nigeria. The federal government itself has told us that those people are coming from outside, that they are Fulani all the same. And now we saw the governor so that we can see that these things are not happening by accident. We saw the governor of Bauchi State come to national TV again to tell us that Fulani from all over Africa belong to Nigeria. Shortly after, we saw how our borders were thrown open and Fulani poured in from everywhere, even at the time we had a lockdown. And if the Bauchi governor says that they belong here, and our president, who happens to be one of them, throws our border open, compromising our collective sovereignty. Now, in every nook and cranny of Nigeria, you have these people, actually killing people. And when you look at what might be their reason for doing all of what they are doing, they are calling it a bandit now. No, what we have managed to establish is a clear-cut, orchestration of ethnic cleansing. People thought it was, of course, they had to call it all kinds of things to deceive the international community. They said it was farmers and herders clashes, but there was no clash anywhere. You were in your community. People turned up there you know, to kill you. Everywhere you turn, you find a new set of people coming to kill people. And then when you look at it, you see they carry AK-47. When the people who have been attacked begin to organize themselves, immediately somebody comes from government with gun to now accuse them. We saw it happen 1 million times in Southern Kaduna. And so it came to where, upon a closer look, we saw a joint venture between the Fulani that wants to establish a homeland for Fulani of all over, from all over Africa in Nigeria, and an ISIS that had been pushed out from Middle East that wanted a new operational base in this sub-region and being welcomed by our own federal government. These things I'm saying, I've said in Congress on Capitol Hill, our State Department, when the US was looking frantically for answers. What is it that is happening? Why is it that the Nigerian government is not doing anything at all? And we just showed them what we took to them, what we knew about it, to say there's a holding of hands between this ISIS that has found a local agent called Boko Haram. And when you look back at the fact that at the time Jonathan was being put under pressure, and he offered a meeting that would have held in Saudi Arabia. You remember that Boko Haram nominated somebody that would speak for them. It says Muhammad Buhari. In that same period, Buhari wasn't yet president, but he was always the one to say that an attack on Boko Haram is an attack on the North. Put all of it together. You saw his defense minister say that, that there were old grazing routes. People have put developments on it. If you don't remove the development, then the cows will find their way. Defense minister, at the time people were being killed. You saw the governor of Benue that went to cry to the president, the commander-in-chief, the only one that controlled all the arms in the land. They are killing my people. What did the president tell him? He said, oh, go home and learn how to live in peace with the Fulani of Benue, whatever that means. And we have seen claims of how Fulani owns everybody and everywhere. That's their claim. Even yesterday, they rolled out something again about conquest. In which war did Fulani conquer the whole of Nigeria? Where did it happen? So whether you, with any angle you look at it from, you will see an orchestration that these people are clear-minded in what they are doing. They're in control of all the armed services. Look at this map again. You will see that whether you're looking at the army or police or the Air Force or immigration or customs or DSS, all the top command positions, even local commands, the people who actually hold the key to the armory are from this part. They are from the yellow part. And this same part, to tell you the nature of the problem we have now, the union is in dispute, and we have declared that dispute. We'll come to that later. But in year 2000, for a Nigeria that is supposed to be a secular state, that was what we agreed to be. We're supposed to be a federation and a secular state. We are no longer a federation because the federating regions have been broken down, and we've ended up with a 36-state unitary structure. Now, even the matter of being a secular union, we were here when in year 2000, 12 contiguous states simultaneously imposed Sharia, contiguous, simultaneous. And when you saw that the state assemblies acted in passing the law, the governors signed the laws and began to set up the enforcement mechanism that include Hizba, such that people from other parts of the country had to relocate from those places. And then we looked at it, tried everything we could to show them that what they were doing might bring our union to an abrupt end. They didn't listen. And we interpreted it eventually to mean that they had seceded. As this contiguous belt, they have seceded from the secular union we were trying to build. At that time, the constitution that was brought back in 1999, that was first made in 1979, which was for us the charter of victory from the war of 1967 to 1970. For those who are the older of our audience, they will remember that it was Murtala Mohammed that commissioned what became 1979 constitution. Immediately he overthrew Gowon. That was the first task he gave up to Rotimi Williams, who then brought the teacher with the lecturer from University of Lagos, Ben Nwabuezi, Professor Ben Nwabuezi, a young teacher. They wrote a draft according to the instruction of Murtala Mohammed, for what will become the basis of constitution. It was that draft that was given to the Constituent Assembly of 1977. The Constituent Assembly worked all through many of the recommendations, many of what was contained in that draft were not accepted by the Constituent Assembly. They came up with a clean draft of what will become constitution, submitted to Obasanjo. Of course, Murtala Mohammed had been assassinated in 1976, but that draft passed on to Obasanjo that took his place, and then he became the working material for that Constituent Assembly, which submitted a clean copy of what they had done. The Constituent Assembly did not accept the retention of the states that were created to destroy the regions. The states were actually created for the purpose of making sure that the regions were weakened. All their assets were taken over by the federal government. That's how we came to this unitarianism we're still struggling with to date. So those states were not created for taking us any forward. It was for the purpose of hijacking the federation by that central government. And progressively, where did we end? Obasanjo to tell us the kind of the origin, the, where this, these problems are flowing from. On the 21st of September in 1978, Obasanjo went on national broadcast to announce 17 amendments to the finished work of the Constituent Assembly. It was what the Supreme Military Council of the time had done that became the Constitution of 1979. Of course, we have seen in the one of 99 that they merely carried it forward, added the states that created the in-between. So everything we needed to have in order to get to where a country of our size, a country of our diversity should be going, we are doing the opposite. Look at where we have ended up. For a country that sells close to 3 million barrels of crude oil every day, we have become the poverty capital of the world. For a country that has the kind of human material and endowments that Nigeria has, we are excelling all over the world, except in our country. For a country of 200 million people, we're still discussing 3,000 and 5,000 megawatts of electricity. Only last week, I actually saw somebody speaking on behalf of government, boasting how they are now going to 5,000 megawatts. For 200 million people, with all the potentials we have, why is it so? Because electricity generation and transmission is on that exclusive list. The refineries that are not working, the petrol you have to pay more for every day. What's the reason? Because refining, oil and gas refining, is on that exclusive list. There's nothing anybody's going to be able to do to solve that problem except that constitution goes down. The insecurity we have, because arms and ammunition are on that exclusive list, the governors can't access even one rifle, even the vigilantes they're setting up. The police that is now controlled by one small community in one corner of Nigeria is the one that will arrange for how you get your gun. If they don't like the gun in your hand, you can't have anything to organize your own security. Yet you have to make laws. How are you going to enforce those laws? So in all of this, anything that is the problem, anything anybody can, and if the listeners and viewers should please feel free to raise their questions. Anything that has become a big problem in Nigeria, I will show you the section of the constitution that is responsible for it, which if that constitution does not go down, that problem will not go away, no matter what you do. Corruption is created and reinforced and protected by that constitution. Therefore, we are not dealing with a situation where officials are corrupt. Corruption is official under our constitution. Why do I say so? We have the governor that is supposed to be for the welfare of the citizen. We have in section 6, subsection 6C, a provision that practically absolves government of responsibilities towards citizens. I want people to confront the lawyers in the land with these things, these specifics. Section 6, subsection 6C, nullifies the whole of chapter 2. Chapter 2 of the Constitution is where all the benefits accruable to the citizen is written in the social contract that Constitution is supposed to be. Now, that means the government does for you only what it wants to do for you. You go from there to the appropriation provisions. Section 81 says the president has to go to National Assembly to obtain permission to spend money. Section 82 says that while they're debating in National Assembly, he's at liberty to run government spending all the money, subject to 50% of what was approved the year before, not what was spent. And so it becomes, you know, a blank check in the hands of the heads of the executive branch, the president and the 36 governors, to take all the money in the treasury. That's what we've been living with. You now come to Section 308 that give them blanket immunity. So if they do not owe the citizen any obligation and they have the spare key to the treasury and you cannot question them why they're in office, you must be a criminal to say you are fighting corruption with such a constitution. Anybody who comes to say he wants to fight corruption under that constitution, because we've been shouting about these matters since the first 3 weeks. This constitution was introduced in 1999. We've gone to court to say, let us do it differently so that this house will not collapse on all of us. Look at the number of people that are dying every day. All the wars going on around the world do not produce even half the number of casualties that are emanating from Nigeria, simply because we have chosen to build on a foundation that cannot carry anything other than that cannot produce anything other than what we are seeing. There's no solution to the problem outside taking down that constitution and getting those who are trapped here, because the problem with everybody thinks, oh, let's go and write another constitution. I even see people in National Assembly saying they're doing an amendment, they're writing another constitution. Our sovereignty is with us. National Assembly, let it be heard loud and clear across the land, because it will soon become a problem for which people are going to be chasing other people to their father's house. Telling our people that we are building on a foundation that is damaged. The House of Nigeria.